Hello friends, welcome to this session on appraisal interview methods. Before we dive into this topic, let us discuss some basics of performance appraisal. Performance appraisal is an ongoing process of evaluating employee performance. It is a review of employee performance over time and so is just one piece of performance management. If performance appraisals are done in the correct manner, they can provide us with a series of valuable results. However, if done incorrectly, the process of evaluating employee performance can actually lead to lower levels of job satisfaction and productivity. The term performance appraisal has been called by many names like performance review, performance evaluation, personal rating, merit rating, employee appraisal, or employee evaluation. Performance appraisal refers to any personal decision that affects the status of employee regarding their retention, termination, promotion, transfer, salary increase or decrease, or admission into a training program. As you are already aware, appraisal methods represent a part in the overall appraisal functionality. Methods for appraising employees' performance can be classified into three main groups: result-oriented methods, behavior-oriented methods, and comparative methods. Let us take a look at each one now. Result-oriented methods. As the word result suggests, the main feature of these methods is that they focus on the system output rather than on the system process. In other words, the job outcome is the primary criteria for effective performance. There are four variants of result-oriented approaches. However, the most common variant is management by objectives, MBO. MBO is a process in which managers and their employees jointly set objectives for the employee, periodically evaluate the performance, and reward according to the results. Management by objectives is a dynamic system that seeks to integrate an organization's need to clarify and achieve goals and objectives with the individual's need to contribute and develop himself. It is a demanding and rewarding style of managing business. This implies that management by objectives is directed towards harmonizing individual goals with those of the organization. Therefore, it seeks to create a sense of common purpose and common direction amongst the management of an organization in the fulfillment of business goals. What exactly happens in MBO? In this method, manager and employee get together to set objectives in quantifiable terms. This appraisal method works to eliminate communication problems by the establishment of regular meetings, emphasizing results, and by being an ongoing process where new objectives are established and old objectives are modified as per changed conditions. Management by objectives provides employees a rich picture on how well they are performing their jobs. In fact, one of the greatest advantages claimed for MBO is that it provides a basis for evaluating employees' performance according to predetermined objectives and standards. It is a widely accepted approach for assessing employees' performance. Its popularity is due to the philosophy that rewarding employees for their accomplishment is important. It decreases the likelihood for employees to work in a direction unrelated to the organization's objectives and purposes. The next is behavior-oriented methods. With result-oriented methods, job outcomes are used as criteria for assessing the employee's performance. In contrast, behavior-oriented methods consider behavior or processes as prime criteria for assessing performance. This group encompasses four important techniques. Let us see which. The first is narrative essay method. The narrative or essay method requires the manager to write a statement about the employee's performance. Under this method, appraiser describes the performance of the employee in terms of strengths and weaknesses of the employee's behavior using his own words. This description usually includes the employee's strengths, weaknesses, and potential as well as recommendation for improvement. This system can vary from organization to organization. In some organizations, managers may be allowed to write whatever they want while in some others, they may be required to answer questions about employees' performance. In the former, the appraiser can do the assessment quickly and with a minimum effort. In the latter, the assessment takes the form of a free essay, or the appraisal is given a few general headings under which he is required to write generalized comments. This method allows the appraiser a wide scope to identify an area that needs addressing and doesn't confine performance to results. The strength of this technique lies in its simplicity and flexibility. However, friends, the weaknesses of this approach come ironically from its strengths. Since the essay is unstructured, the appraiser's writing ability skills determine its results. This makes it a little tricky to compare employees rated by different managers across the same organization. Additionally, the essay appraisal provides qualitative data, and human resource management decisions can be improved by quantitative data, which can be compared and ranked objectively. The essay method thus provides insight about the appraiser and the appraisee. Moving on to the next method, trait or graphic rating scales. This is one of the oldest and very common, perhaps the most popular way to appraise performance. Such scales consist of two parts. First, a variety of dimensions that are thought to be indicators of high performance outcomes in a specific job, and that the employee is accordingly expected to exhibit. Examples of these dimensions could be initiative, reliability, cooperation, creativity, and so on. Second, a scale which allows the appraiser to assign the employee's scores on each dimension. The trait approaches to performance appraisal are designed to measure the extent to which an employee possesses certain characteristics like dependability, creativity, and initiative that are viewed as important for the job and the organization in general. These are easy to develop. The major advantages of graphic scales lie in its ease of use, less time required to develop and administer, its usage for a wide range of jobs, and the quantitative results it gives. Generally, rating scales do not provide objective evaluation because the dimensions used are usually vague and imprecise. For example, let us consider the dimensions of cooperation and creativity. It is difficult for two persons to agree on their meaning. Additionally, they fail to provide enough specific feedback for employees' improvement. For instance, if an employee is rated as far below average on creativity, this does not help in planning performance improvement. Furthermore, rating scales are extremely susceptible to errors such as halo effect, central tendency, leniency, strictness, and hence are not reliable in making zero-sum decisions because they provide qualitative information. Alright, the third is critical incident method. This procedure of performance appraisal was developed by Flanagan and Burns. It is also referred to as critical requirements system and the performance record program. Under this method of performance appraisal, lists of statements of very effective and very ineffective behavior for employees are drawn out. The manager keeps a written record for highly favorable and unfavorable actions in an employee's performance, which may affect positively or negatively the department's effectiveness. The list is combined into categories which vary with the job. Once the categories have been developed and statements of effective and ineffective behavior have been provided, the appraiser prepares a log for each employee. During the appraisal period, the evaluator records examples of critical behaviors in each of the categories, and the log is used to evaluate the employee at the end of the evaluation period. This technique is an attempt to move away from trait rating scales, in which the manager writes down positive and negative performance behavior of employees throughout the performance period. And lastly, the behaviorally anchored rating scales, BARS. Behaviorally anchored rating scale is a performance appraisal method combining rating and critical incidents. It is more objective and accurate than the two methods separately. Rather than having excellent, good, average, and so forth, this method provides several statements that describe the employee's performance, from which the manager selects the one that best describes the employee's performance for the task. The manager is asked to rate the employee according to items on a long continuum. These items represent the actual behavior on the job rather than a general description of traits. The development of behavioral anchored rating scale is a significant breakthrough in terms of utilization of critical incidents to evaluate performance. These scales combine major elements from the critical incidents and graphic rating scale methods. Friends, to understand all this better, let us take an example of a restaurant waiter and see what ratings he will get for a particular performance. We will discuss the performance category, rating, and customer relations for our example. For performance category extremely outstanding performance, a rating 7 may be given, and the example could be, you can expect the waiter to help the customer in need. For good performance, a rating 6 can be given, where you can expect the waiter to calm down arguments before they erupt into fights. For fairly good performance, a rating 5 can be given, where you can expect the waiter to wait for directions from his senior management in case of any issues. For acceptable performance, a rating 4 can be given, where you can expect the waiter to stop serving drinks to those who are intoxicated and are alone. For fairly poor performance, a rating 3 can be given, where you can expect the waiter to make no conversation with customers who are alone. For poor performance, a rating 2 can be given, where you can expect the waiter to check identification of customers in case they ask for drinks. For extremely poor performance, a rating 1 can be given, where you can expect the waiter to pick up customers' dishes before they have finished, just because it is time to close. Comparative methods. Comparative methods of performance appraisal use comparative techniques to differentiate performance between employees. This group encompasses the techniques such as ranking, weighted checklist, forced choice, forced distribution, graphic rating scale, and paired comparison methods. Under these methods, the manager simply checks off the employee's level of performance. Some of the possible areas evaluated include quality and quantity of work, judgment, attitude, cooperation, and initiative. We will discuss each method now. Ranking method. Ranking is a performance appraisal method that is used to evaluate employee performance from best to worst. The term ranking has been used to describe a method of performance appraisal where the manager has been asked to order his employees in terms of performance from highest to lowest. Under the ranking method, the manager compares an employee to another employee rather than measuring each one to a standard measurement. Although this method is simple to understand and easy to apply, difficulties arise when a large number of individuals are to be evaluated in the organization. Weighted checklist method. Under this method, managers prepare a large list of descriptive statements about effective and ineffective behavior on jobs. If the rater believes the employee possessed a trait listed, the rater checks the item. If not, the rater leaves the item blank. Rating scores from the checklist are then equaled to the number of checks. Forced choice method. This procedure forms another measure to overcome the problems of personal bias and lack of objectivity in performance appraisal. It forces the appraiser to select from a series of statements describing job proficiency or personal traits the one statement which is most descriptive of the individual being evaluated. Simultaneously, the appraiser is also required to select from the same series of statements the one which is least descriptive of the individuals. This most least procedure is repeated until all the series of statements have been reviewed by the appraiser. Usually, each set of statements consists of 5 statements, 2 complementary, 2 uncomplementary, and 1 neutral. This method reduces the errors of leniency, halo effect, and central tendency. However, this procedure is costly in practice and requires intensive research to devise the forced choice scale. Forced distribution method. This method is similar to grading on a curve. The evaluator is asked to rate employees in some fixed distributions of categories. One way to do this has been to type the name of each employee on a card and ask the evaluator to sort the cards into piles corresponding to rating. This procedure permits evaluation of individuals on one or more scales with certain percentage of individuals stipulated for each scale location. A predetermined percentage of employees are placed in certain performance categories. For example, excellent 5%, average 60%, below average 15%, and poor 5%. These percentages are used as guideposts and not as rigid rules. Usually, no descriptive phrases are used in this procedure. This method avoids the danger that appraisers may become over-lenient or the likelihood that the standards may be interpreted differently by different appraisers. Graphic rating scale method. This method is the oldest and most widely used in evaluating performance of employees. The evaluators are given a graph and asked to rate the employees on each of the characteristics. The number of characteristics can vary from 1 to 100. The rating can be a matrix of boxes for the evaluator to check off or a bar graph where the evaluator checks off a location relative to the evaluator's rating. Friends, it is important to understand that there are many variations of the graphic rating scale. The differences are to be found in the characteristics or dimensions on which individuals are rated, the degree to which the performance dimension is defined for the rater, and how clearly the points on the scale are defined. Also, the rating form should provide sufficient space for comments on the behavior associated with each scale. These comments improve the accuracy of appraisal. Paired comparison method. This appraisal method facilitates ranking of employees. First, the names of the employees to be evaluated are placed on separate sheets in a predetermined order so that each person can be compared with all other employees to be evaluated. The evaluator then checks the person he feels is better of the two on the criterion for each comparison. The criterion revolves around the employee's overall ability to do the present job. The number of times a person has been preferred is tallied, and the tally developed is an index of the number of preferences compared to the number being evaluated. Okay, so let us take a quick look at summary in the form of advantages and disadvantages of various appraisal methods. Advantages of trait methods: they are inexpensive to develop, they use meaningful dimensions, and they are easy to use. Disadvantages of trait methods: they have high potential for rating errors, they are not useful for employee counseling, they are not useful for allocating rewards, and they are not useful for promotion decisions. Advantages of behavioral methods: they use specific performance dimensions, they are acceptable to employees and superiors, they are useful for providing feedback, and they are fair for reward and promotion decisions. Disadvantages of behavioral methods: they can be time consuming to develop and use, they can be costly to develop, and they have some potential for rating error. Advantages of result methods: they have less subjectivity bias, they are acceptable to employees and superiors, they link individual performance to organizational performance, they encourage mutual goal setting, and they are good for reward and promotion decisions. Disadvantages of result methods: they are time consuming to develop and to use, they may encourage short-term perspective, they may use contaminated criteria, and they may use deficient criteria. Alright friends, now let us move ahead to appraisal interview. Performance appraisal interview is a formal meeting between a manager and an employee to give feedback on performance, from strength to areas of improvement of the employee, with a view to improve the performance further. Generally, performance appraisal interviews are conducted with hard facts and data, but it is the most challenging management activity. Performance appraisal interview is a medium to clear up mutual doubts, queries, and help develop a supportive and healthy relationship between the manager and his subordinates, with an ultimate goal of improving the subordinate's performance. A performance appraisal interview occurs when a manager and employee meet and the employee's job performance is discussed. the manager should avoid a threatening attitude in his conduct of the appraisal interview. The appraisal interview should be seen as a motivational tool. Some organizations use the appraisal interview as a chance to determine the appropriate salary increases for the employee, commonly known as pay for performance. The manager should do everything to make sure that the appraisal system accurately depicts the performance of the employee. When the managers try comparing employees, they can create bad feeling and damage the employee morale. The format for the appraisal interview will be determined in large part by the purpose of the interview, the type of appraisal method used, and the organization of the interview form. Most appraisal interviews attempt to give feedback to employees on how well they are performing their jobs and on planning for their future development. Interviews should be scheduled far enough in advance to allow the interviewee as well as the interviewer to prepare for the discussion. Usually 10 days to 2 weeks is a sufficient amount of lead time. Appraisal interview styles. The individual who has probably studied different approaches to performance appraisal interviews most thoroughly is Norman R.F. Meyer. In his classic book, The Appraisal Interview, he analyzes the cause and effect relationships in different types of appraisal interviews. Tell and sell, tell and listen, and problem solving, to name a few. Tell interview. This style allows little involvement of the employee. This normally represents the autocratic manager that tells the appraisee about his strengths and weaknesses and does not listen to what the employee says about himself. The underlying explanation for such a style is that the manager believes he has the right to judge on the assumption that he knows the best, and so the interview is short. However, this style lacks employee commitment, since the employee feels that his views are not accepted. Tell and sell interview. The appraiser not only does most of the talking, but also tries to achieve the appraisal result by persuading the employee to accept the judgment. However, this style is criticized for lacking in employee commitment. This is because, despite the employee apparently accepting the appraisal result, in reality is dissatisfied with what the manager tries to sell. The skills required in the tell and sell interview include the ability to persuade an employee to change in a prescribed manner. This may require the development of new behaviors on the part of the employee and skillful use of motivational incentives on the part of the appraiser or supervisor. Tell and listen interview. In tell and listen interview, the skills required include the ability to communicate the strong and weak points of an employee's job performance during the first part of the interview. During the second part of the interview, the employee's feelings about the appraisal are thoroughly explored. The supervisor is still in the role of appraiser, but the method requires listening to disagreement and coping with defensive behavior without attempting to refute any statements. The tell and listen method assumes that the opportunity to release frustrated feelings will help to reduce or remove those feelings. Ask and tell interview. Here, the employee is given greater involvement in the appraisal process. The manager begins by asking questions and the employee responds to them, but the manager will finish by taking decisions about the future objectives and will end by telling the employee what he should do. Problem solving interview. The skills associated with the problem-solving interview are consistent with the non-directive procedures of the tell and listen method. Listening, accepting, and responding to feelings are essential elements of the problem-solving interview. However, this method goes beyond an interest in the employee's feelings. It seeks to stimulate growth and development in the employee by discussing the problems, needs, innovations, satisfactions, and dissatisfactions the employee has encountered on the job since the last appraisal interview. Ask and listen interview. Here, the appraisee is given the whole responsibility to assess his performance. The advantages of this style are many. It gains the employee commitment because of its participative style. It reduces defensiveness because the employee takes the responsibility to assess his performance. It challenges the employee to think about his performance and to provide some suggestions for improvement. However, this style is criticized because the employee may not highlight areas of weakness, since most of the control is in his hands. However, friends, you need to make a note that managers should not assume that only one type of appraisal interview is appropriate for every review session. Rather, they should be able to use one or more of the interview types depending on the topic being discussed or on the behavior of the employee being appraised. The interview should be seen as requiring a flexible approach. We have thus come to the end of this session. Let us see what your retention and key takeaway from this session should be. For undertaking performance appraisal successfully, determining the best appraisal methods depends upon the objectives of the organization. A combination of the methods is usually superior to any one method. For developmental objectives, critical incidents and MBO work well. For administrative decisions, a ranking method based on rating scales or bars works well. We all know a perfect world does not exist. In this light, none of the various appraisal methods that have been discussed are perfect. Each method has its advantages and drawbacks and serves different purposes. The success of the performance appraisal process does not just lie in the formal method or form used once or twice a year. It depends on the manager's human relations skills in ongoing critical incidents coaching and on effective measures of performance that are accurate. This will help everyone know why they are rated at a given level, evaluative, as well as how to improve, develop for the next assessment. Also, there is no single best style for appraisal interviews as it depends on the circumstances and the choice of the style is affected by some factors like organizational culture, manager's own style and experience, and behavior of the employee himself. The appraisee's readiness in terms of job experience and prior experience in appraisal also needs to be considered when choosing an appraisal interview style. For example, when an employee is new to the job and has never been subjected to appraisal, it could be appropriate to apply the tell style. On the other hand, ask and listen style could be used when the employee has a rich experience in the job and has been appraised several times. That is all for this session. Thank you.